Thank you, thank you, Peter. Good afternoon, everyone. So the title of my presentation is "A lot of smart ideas, too bad they don't work." I'll get right to the reason for this title, but first I want to introduce our team. The ISPL is the acronym for Image and Sound Processing Lab, and the ISPL is a research group at Politecnico di Milano with the goal of developing state-of-the-art solutions for multimedia. But about 10 years ago, following an internal restructuring of our department, the members of the seismic processing group, of which I was a part, joined the ISPL to exploit possible synergies. So the ISPL team that participated in the challenge is made up of me, then Luca Bondi, which is now working as a research scientist at Bosch, and then two PhD students, which are Francesco Picetti and Edoardo Cannas. And this is the official team for the competition, but also Paolo Bestaggini took part in our weekly meeting. So in the end, we are five engineers. We have expertise in signal processing, machine learning, deep learning, and in seismic imaging, seismic processing, seismic inversion. Not very strong expertise in geology. So why we participate to this challenge? Well, Paolo and I have been working together for a few years to apply machine learning to geophysical problems. And in 2016, when we heard about the SEG machine learning contest, we wanted to take advantage of that opportunity. That it was one of the first efforts to raise the visibility of machine learning into the geophysical community. That experience was very positive. Some of the solutions we proposed turned out to be very influential, and we ranked among the top teams. So when last summer I learned about the fourth contest, I immediately called Paolo and told him, listen, we have to participate at least to defend our good reputation. At the SEG Machine Learning Contest, our solution was pretty simple. It was based on XGBoost, on an appropriate validation scheme, and a bit of feature engineering, which at that occasion proved to be the keystone for our good score. And to give the due recognition, I must admit that the feature engineering was all thanks to Paolo Bestaggini. All top teams at the SEG context had more or less the same approach. So when I saw the data set of the fourth challenge, I was immediately impressed by the number of wells and the features available. So more features, some different type of information, new technology, 5 years of innovation and diffusion of deep learning and machine learning. So the scenario looked completely changed, and we wondered what the winning strategies may be. Let's take a look. Ensemble of trees, some feature engineering, accurate cross-validation. And in my opinion, was the cross-validation the key of Olawale victory. However, at first this puzzled me. How it's possible? The same kind of solution of 5 years ago. So when Peter sent the email saying that this was organized, this meeting, my idea was not to prepare any presentation, because our solution was quite standard. But then I thought about all the smart ideas we had during our meeting for the competition. And maybe I saw that it was worth to discuss this idea and to think about their failure. Therefore, there are no answers in this presentation, but questions. I'll present all the ideas we tried to move away from the standard solution, trying to understand why they have not led to good results. So let's go and examine the reason behind some of these attempts. First of all, if we consider a standard approach, we are treating each sample as independent from the others, while we are clearly dealing with sequences. This is not exactly true, because through preprocessing, for instance, through filtering, transform, we are considering somehow the sequential nature of the data. However, ultimately, the samples are treated independently. Another aspect to consider is that we now have access to information on the position of the well. And this is currently used just as one feature among the others. Why we know that the region in which the well is located is of great importance. And we want to exploit this information. Other things to take into account: class imbalance, the score which is weighted, and the impact of some classes in the classification. So this time we were confident that the data was much more than in the SDG context. So we decided to try deep learning and to do a big test, set of tests. I won't go into much detail of the architecture. However, in addition to sequence models such as LSTM and transformer, we also tested convolutional and fully connected networks. We tried different combination of hyperparameters, different depth of the network, for a total of over 1,300 tests. Some of the results are summarized in this histogram, which refers to our validation score. No test achieved a validation score that improved our baseline with XGBoost. Just in case, we also made a couple of submissions with our best validation results, but they've gone much worse than we got with XGBoost. Possible reasons. What we saw is that we think that these are a lot of data, but maybe from a deep learning perspective, these are not so much. Furthermore, in this case, we didn't dispose of any pre-trained network to try to do some transfer learning on something similar. However, we also looked for other ways to consider the sequential nature of the data. For example, we implemented a two-step prediction strategy. In the first phase, the prediction is done in the standard way. In the second phase, the model is also trained with neighboring samples and neighboring fetches. In test, the prediction obtained during the first stage are given as an input as features for the second stage. Again, the results were very poor. In this case, probably the problem is to use the samples of the first prediction as features, regardless of the confidence of the prediction. And maybe this is a possible improvement of this strategy. Finally, we decided to act in post-processing, always with the idea that there are sequences less probable than others. So the things that partially worked was to avoid isolated faces just through a medium filter. but we wanted to do something more by checking if in the training dataset there were any combination triplets in our attempts of any triplets or stretches that were never present. Indeed, there were combinations that never appeared in the training. Too bad they never appeared also in the predicted phases. So this was a smart idea, but completely useless. There is another idea that we had no time to implement, which we are working now on, and concern the modeling of the probability of passing from a phases to another, considered as a change of state in a Markov chain. We hope that this doesn't just become a new slide in this presentation of failures. Second macro theme is to exploit the information on the position of the wells. In the standard model, it is essentially one feature among the others. But we know that is a fundamental information because there is a regional aspect of the interpretation. Otherwise, we could take the model we trained for this challenge and make prediction, I don't know, maybe in Gulf of Mexico. So the well in the dataset cover a fairly large area, and it's quite evident that they can be clusterized. And we identified here three clusters identified by green, yellow, and blue dots. We used this information in two ways. The first one is inspired by some Kaggle competition for that of predicting the selling price of a house. In that case, one thing that works is to combine the distance from some significant points, for example, schools, shopping center, and so on, in the future vector. So we added to the future vector the distance from the cluster centers. The second strategy consists simply in training three different models for the three clusters. This strategy also did not lead to any improvement. A possible explanation for this. First of all, maybe we underestimated the fact that the geographical information was already present through the well coordinates in the feature vector. And moreover, probably the underlying idea was not so right, and we paid for the absence of the geologist or an interpreter in our group, because the clustering we have done depends only on the mutual distance between the wells, but there is nothing that tells us that this region have a link with homogeneous areas from a geological point of view. Probably with the help of geologists, the cluster could be implemented differently. By taking the concept of the previous slide to the limit, we came up with another strategy. This time the idea was to generate a model for each test well, using only the neighboring key wells. The underlying logic was the idea of overfitting on the basis of a strong geographical proximity. The graph here showed the trend of the validation score as the number of neighbors increases. We see that with few neighbors, it doesn't work at all, because we are overfitting on the single wells and not on the generalizing on the small area. When the number of neighbors increases, we are falling back in the previous slide situation. We also made some attempts to exploit the particularities of the dataset. For example, the unbalance of the data. And the fact that, for example, the metrics above represent one of our models, and this is related to the confusion matrix, but represents how much score we have lost due to a particular classification error. And we observe that most of the score is lost in this upper left corner. So we tried, for example, finding encrusted ways to separate, for instance, based on gamma ray, sensors and shells. A trick just for the score with no geological meaning, just to group all the small classes in a single class. Even pretend that only the first three classes exist. We try to establish hierarchies between classes, write the samples differently, but the list of attempts will be numerous and boring. But also in this case, in some cases, I will say almost fortunately, we have not significant improvements. In the end, our best model was one of the simplest. XGBoost classifier, it has some pre-processing, quite standard. The only difference with respect to the SG contest may be that we train the different models with respect to the different number of features in each test well. And finally, we did the soft voting of the five best models. Conclusions. To conclude, we proposed many alternative strategies to the most straightforward one, but we did not achieve any improvements. Probably with this data and with this strategy, based only on the data, we are almost at the limit of what can be achieved. We still have the feeling that alternative strategies are possible. However, probably to attempt alternative strategies, such those we have tried, one cannot ignore the introduction of appropriate geological knowledge. Thank you. If you have any question, I'm here to answer.
Thanks a lot, Vincenzo. That was a good talk. Are there any questions in the audience? Does anybody want to ask a hard question?
I was very curious about looking at the location of the wells close to one another. You showed the geographic distribution of the
Yes.
wells. And it seemed to me that whenever I, looked at the importance of features, the features that always jumped to the top were formation and group. Like they were far and away the most important features when I did permutation importance or when I looked to see what was working in my model. And I wondered if to what extent the geology reflect, the formation and group reflect the location of the wells, if that's something you noticed or if that's something you explored.
We didn't check that. We didn't check. As I said, we are not geologists, so we have not the experience of on this. So probably this kind of clustering was wrong. This is the idea. We just based on a computer vision-like clustering, which is not the true clustering for this kind of data. Maybe combining formation and group and geographical position, we could do some better clustering.
Okay, thanks a lot.